Hi, and welcome back. I recently made an introduction video for Volcano 3, in which I teased some drum synth patches, and I've seen a lot of requests for a tutorial. So here it is. Actually, this one is just going to cover the 808 style kick drum, which was the most complex of the sounds I used, with the rest to follow along later. However, it's a basic fact of drum synthesis that very small changes to things like envelope and modulation settings can result in big differences to the sound, and you should expect to have to spend a lot of time tweaking settings minutely to get where you want to be. It's largely for this reason that I'm going to switch around my usual tutorial approach for this video, and instead of building up the patch from the default preset, I'm going to start with my final settings and deconstruct them for you. If you try to recreate my settings, you'll probably get something quite different to begin with, but if I do a good enough job explaining what each filter and envelope is doing, you'll hopefully be able to make all those fine little tweaks to get it closer to what I had, or to whatever sound you have in your head. Because this is the great benefit of being able to synthesize drum sounds, of course. You don't have to spend ages trawling through folders of drum samples looking for one that fits your production. You can simply roll your own and tailor it to fit perfectly. Every patch in this series starts with white noise. It doesn't really matter what you use. I've just got a stock Reaper noise generator on this track, followed by an instance of Volcano 3. And every patch will also require that you route MIDI to that instance of Volcano. The method will depend on your DAW, so maybe check the manual if you're not sure how to achieve this. When it's set up correctly, you should see the yellow MIDI indicator light up at the bottom left of the interface when you send MIDI data. This is required because every envelope I use in these presets will be triggering from MIDI, rather than the main or sidechain audio inputs. Okay, let's break down this 808 kick sound. What I'm about to show you isn't the only way to create this kind of sound, of course, and probably not even the usual way, but it has some advantages, as we shall see. So first thing to note is I'm using three filters, but importantly, they're routed so that filters 1 and 2 are running in parallel with each other. Then their outputs are being mixed together and processed with filter 3. Let's start with filter 3. This is a high-pass filter, tuned down low in the sub-bass region, which is doing two things. It's removing very low-frequency content that's too low to be useful, and helping to tighten up the sound. But more importantly, it also has a lot of resonance, which is self-oscillating and adding a low fundamental. Notice what happens if I bypass this filter. We lose all of that characteristic 808 boom, and we're left with a pretty conventional kick drum sound. There's some important modulation going on with this filter. Let's start with the cutoff, which is modulated from envelope 2 to provide that downwards drop in pitch. This modulation is optional. I could leave the resonance at a single static frequency. That still works. And I could optionally turn on the keyboard graphic and tune it to a specific musical note. Or of course, I could exaggerate the pitch modulation by turning up the modulation depth. Or tame it by turning it down. And all these variations result in quite a different feel. I'm also modulating the output level for filter 3 using envelope 3. Attack is again at its fastest setting. But it's important to note that when synthesizing drum sounds, we normally want to ignore MIDI note off messages, so that the drum sounds the same regardless of how long you hold down the key. We can make these ADSR envelopes behave like this by setting the sustain to 0, and making sure the decay and release stages are set the same as each other, or at least close enough. Probably the easiest way to achieve this is to double-click and type in values directly. But if you're going to need to tweak an envelope decay on the fly, or just want to make it easier to adjust, you can link a slider to control both decay and release at the same time, as I've done here. So I can easily rein in the length of that boom if it's too much. Notice, however, that each envelope stage also has a curve control. Most of the time, snappier, more exponential decay settings will work better for percussion or drum sounds. But in this case, I'm going for a rather unnatural sustained boom, so I've dragged it the opposite way instead. But don't forget that, ideally, you'll want to match the curve for the release stage as well. This is easier to see if I temporarily turn up the sustain. Again, you can double-click and type in a value, rather than trying to match them with a mouse drag. As the filter's self-oscillation is a big part of this sound, it shouldn't surprise you to learn that the filter style can have a big impact. When you switch styles, you'll probably find you need to tweak the resonance and drive as well. Some styles work better for this than others, but most are capable of creating a satisfying boom when tweaked correctly. Don't forget to try changing the filter steepness as well. But I'm a big fan of the metal style for this kind of thing, as it has very powerful resonance at low frequencies. Okay, let's bypass filter 3 again and talk about filter 2. This isn't self-oscillating, rather it's just shaping the noise input. Let's turn off filter 1 as well, and listen to filter 2 on its own. And it's literally just the click component, like the slam of the kick drum beater hitting the batter head. The only modulation is of the level, from envelope 1. Again, I have the fastest possible attack. And the curve of the decay is almost at its snappiest, most exponential setting. Once again, I've matched the timing and curve settings for the decay and the release. More or less, anyway. Let's put filter 1 back in and bypass filter 2. Interestingly, filter 1 on its own is still convincingly a kick drum. But notice how dramatically the character changes when I add the click from filter 2. Or if I change the cutoff frequency for filter 2. Settings between about 3 and 6k tend to work well for the click. And tuning this to suit your specific mix can make a huge difference to the perceived clarity and punch of your kick drum. Okay, let's bypass filter 2 again and talk about filter 1. It's a low-pass filter, but it's well into self-oscillation territory with the peak knob cranked up high, so in practice is behaving more like an oscillator than a filter. It's tuned down low, around that 50 Hz region, to give us the low thump of a kick drum. But much of that thumpy character comes from the cutoff modulation from envelope 1. If I turn that off, it's not very thumpy at all anymore. The modulation level is critical here. If I turn it up higher, we start to get into more techno territory. And likewise, the envelope timing is also critical. If I reduce the decay and release settings to half their current values, and turn up the modulation depth again, we get an altogether different kick drum sound. I also have the output level modulated, this time from envelope 2, which is again doing two jobs, modulating both filter 3 cutoff and filter 1 gain. And it has a very percussive, snappy curve setting once again, which I've matched for the release stage as well. Or actually, I haven't in this case. Oops. Of course, a mistake like this might not matter if all your MIDI notes are long enough, as the envelopes won't ever switch to the release stage in that case. Okay, so that's everything, I think. Let's put the click back from filter 2, and the 808 boom from filter 3, and there's our sound in full. Except it's not actually the full sound, as I have some post-processing. First, an instance of Saturn 2, running the warm tube style. And you can see I've not been shy with the drive knob. If I bypass, that makes quite a big difference. Of course, distorting 808 type sounds is hardly a new trick. As well as adding character and attitude, it also helps the part to not disappear on smaller speakers with no subwoofers. And I also have a compressor as well, adding some extra consistent punch to the attack, and helping to make the boomy tail of the sound bloom in a satisfying manner. Now, you may be thinking I've missed a couple of tricks when building this patch. Shouldn't a drum preset be velocity sensitive, for one thing? And wouldn't a pitched 808 type preset benefit from keyboard tracking, so you can transpose the note up or down by playing different keys? Potentially, the answer to both those questions is yes. However, I personally quite like this type of sound to not be velocity sensitive. There's something exciting about being able to unleash a powerful low boom with even the slightest touch. And I find it more inspiring to play this kind of part in that way. And in the specific musical context that I made this preset, I didn't want the boom to change note, so I didn't add keyboard tracking either. Rest assured, however, I'll be showing how to do both those things as I cover the other drum sounds I created. So look out for the next video. That's all for now. Thanks for watching.